All right, fine class. We'll pray and we can get started for today. Would somebody like to lead in prayer for the class to begin, please? Okay, anyone? Okay, I think lead in prayer, we can get started. Did you hear me, Dev?
Okay, ma'am, I'll do it.
Yeah, sure, thank you.
Father, we thank you for this wonderful week ahead, Lord Jesus, and we thank you that for this day today as we come together and learn, Lord Jesus. Let your spirit and your anointing be upon Pastor Nancy, and with your spirit, we even open up our heart, Lord Jesus, so that we can understand what your daughter is teaching to us, Lord Jesus, so that we can accept it, Lord Jesus, and we can use it in our life, Lord God. I pray that your spirit to be with all of us, each one of us, with those who are joining, with those who haven't yet joined. I pray that you'll be with us and help us and guide us and take us through these classes, Lord Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Dave. So let's begin once again with 1 John. So we will have a quick review of what we had discussed in the last class, the main themes that were covered in 1 John chapter 1. We stopped somewhere, you know, around verse 14, I think, of chapter 2. So we will continue from there, but we will first have a small recap. So, would anyone like to share some of the common themes that we discussed in chapter 1? You can look at your Bibles, you can look at the passage to see what is mentioned over there, that's fine. So you can look at it and tell me. Common themes. What did we discuss? Okay, someone will have to share so that we can move forward. So whatever you remember.
Common thing is love of God, the divinity.
Yes. Yes, Thomas. You said love of God, and then I couldn't hear your voice.
Love of God and divinity, Jesus Christ.
Okay. Divinity. Oh, okay. Great. Yes. That's something we saw, you know, God's love and the divinity of Christ. We saw the fact that the Lord Jesus, even though he was fully man, that, you know, he's fully God. And there's a very strong emphasis that John lays on. He says that we have seen, we have heard, we have known. So he is talking about the humanity of Christ and confirming that, you know, the Lord Jesus was not a mythological figure. In those days, you know, there were all kinds of philosophies where people believed that the Lord Jesus was probably not human, that he had some sort of, you know, supernatural powers, which is why hanging on the cross did not really hurt him, or he did not feel the pain of it. But We are very clear from what John is saying. He's saying that the things which he's sharing by way of being an eyewitness. So he emphasizes that. And the divinity of Christ comes through even as he emphasizes the humanity of Christ. Okay, so that is something we saw. We saw that the Lord Jesus is spoken of as the word of life. Okay, he's spoken of as the word of life. Are there any other titles that you see, or any other descriptors of the Lord Jesus that you see in chapter 1? If you could please tell me. Okay, so the same Jesus whose humanity is emphasized is also called the Son of God. So when John says that we have fellowship with the Father and the Son, so he is declaring the deity of Christ. Okay? We also notice that the Lord Jesus, he is in the light and there is no darkness in him. So in God there is no darkness. That's again an emphasis that John has there. And all these things reveal that God is God is perfect, that there is no sin in him, and that God has invited us to have fellowship with Christ. Okay, so these were some of the things that we observed. We also saw that though it's not talking about salvation, this is the message here is for a believer, and we began by saying that the believer can have a fellowship with God. Okay? And this fellowship is once the believer has accepted this eternal life and the Zoe life of God is flowing in and through the believer, on an ongoing basis, we can have that shared life with our God. And that is the beauty of what John is saying. He's saying that it's not just about forgiveness of our sins, but on a continual basis, so we can enjoy the oneness with the Godhead. And he says, you know, our fellowship, it's with the Father and with the Son. And I also talked about the fact that though the Holy Spirit is not mentioned here, we know from Scripture that we are called to have fellowship even with the Holy Spirit. So the beautiful life of a believer is this ongoing communion, this ongoing fellowship with the Godhead. Now, if that connection is missing, right, that's when we may be believers, but we are not in sync with the life of God. The life of God has been granted to us, but it is for us to take and it is for us to walk. You know, we've seen that also mentioned here. But if we walk in the light, he says, so it's about living the life. It's about following after God. It's about receiving that life and releasing it, okay, on a daily basis. So, you know, this is something that shows us that a believer can have a very fulfilled life here on the face of the earth. It's not just about purpose. It's not just about accomplishing what God has called us to do, but it can be a beautiful co-working, partnering, fellowshipping, communing relationship with God. And that is what God has called us to. And we will have that kind of fellowship when we walk in the light, it says. Okay, and we talked about how light and darkness refer to righteousness and sin. So when a believer who has already been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus walks in that righteousness, so there is a positional truth, but there is the truth that we live out through our actions and our choices. So when a believer lives out that life in the truth, No, he can have that continuous fellowship with God because we are walking in the light, and we've already been told that God is light and there is no darkness in him. So in a sense, what John is saying is, he's saying that this is the true Christ. He is both man and he is God. There is no sin in him, and you and I can have fellowship with him and the other persons of the Godhead. But for that, we have to have a walk of righteousness. Okay, if we are not walking in the light, then it is very difficult for us to claim that we are tapping into the life of God. You know, we are receiving that life and we are walking in that light. So, you know, that is the reality which we talked about. And then we also saw how we are encouraged to always keep a check on our walk with the Lord. If there be any sin, we said that we can confess. Okay, we can confess, and God is faithful to forgive us. We also saw how the blood of Jesus cleanses us from our sins. So God has made provision for us to have that continual fellowship with him. God has made provision for us to walk in victory. Every resource for a victorious living has already been given to us. Okay? But the believer has to walk in these things. And that is what we are being called to do here. Okay? The provision is already made, but the believer has to take it. The believer has to acknowledge it. The believer has to live in it. So we were told that a believer must walk in the light. Secondly, a believer must not claim that, you know, he is sinless. If there be anything in his life which keeps him out of fellowship with God, he can confess and he can come back to God, because we saw that the Lord Jesus himself has become that advocate for us, Paracletos, the one who comes alongside, the one who fights for us. And we also saw that he has become the propitiation for our sin, or he has become that sacrifice for our sins. And therefore, you know, what a victorious life. I mean, think about it. A believer has everything he needs or she needs for him or her to walk clean here on the face of the earth and walk victorious, free from sin. So a believer can keep short accounts because already the Lord Jesus has paid the price, and the blood of Jesus is cleansing the believer. Okay. Then we went on to see in chapter 2, we saw a couple of things. We said that if we claim that we know him, we should also keep his commandments. Okay. So if we are saying that we have fellowship with the Godhead, we must walk in the light. If we are saying that we have fellowship with the Godhead, we must not think that, you know, we are self-righteous. If there be any sin in us, we must be willing to acknowledge it. Okay. Thirdly, we see here that if anyone claims to know God, we must obey his commandments. We must walk in his commandments. So you notice it's all about lifestyle. It's all about daily living. It's all about right attitudes towards God, okay, which makes our walk with the Lord fulfilling. Otherwise, imagine a believer who is not following whatever we are discussing right now. Yes, in essence, we have been rescued, we have salvation, but can we have a fulfilling, can we have a flourishing, thriving, wonderful fellowship with God, you know, by living in sin? It's not possible. That's what John wants us to remember. He's saying, look, there is a certain lifestyle which is fruitful, which is blessed, you know, which is so satisfying, and I want you to walk in that way. Okay. Therefore, get rid of all sin from your life, and know that even if there is something that is hindering our walk with the Lord Jesus has already made provision for it. So, you know, we can come clean. We know that the blood of Jesus, and we saw that it is in the present continuous tense, like cleansing that we receive from the blood of Jesus, that it is cleansing us. So it is able to do the work which it has always been powerful to do. And we must keep the commandments of God. And that is the lifestyle, a victorious lifestyle of a believer. And then he goes on to encourage the believers. You know, he gives them okay. Yeah, so we have touched upon other aspects here. How about we start from verse 7, you know, once again, because I think there are a couple of insights which we can talk about, and then, you know, we will continue from there. So here in verse 7, he talks about a commandment that he is giving, and he says this is not a new commandment. So basically, he's encouraging the believer to walk like Jesus. So he's saying that Jesus has already lived these commandments, and that is why. Now, even though it may sound new to you, it's not a new commandment. It's an old commandment which Jesus has already lived out before us. And he talks about the fact that anyone who says that they live in the light and they hate their brother, they are actually in the darkness. So you see, there is a pattern that is following. Now, John is giving us a pattern for our daily life. He's giving us a pattern to fellowship with God, a pattern to receive the life of God every day. And we saw how sin should be out. We saw how we must walk in his commandments. Now, the next important thing that he brings to our notice is love. And love for whom? Love for our brother. So who is our brother? Who is our brother? Any thoughts on that?
Believer.
Yeah, believers, right? Love for our brothers. Usually, you know, the early church used to use that term for those who are in Christ. Okay, so for other Christians, other believers. And he says that if we don't love them, then the love of God is not in us. Look at verse 9 here. Verse 10, sorry. He says, he who loves his brother abides in the light, and there is no cause for stumbling in him. Now, verse 11, but he who hates his brother is in darkness and walks in darkness and does not know where he is going, because the darkness has blinded his eyes. Okay, so here is another prerequisite for us to say that we are living right, we are walking in the light. We love our brothers. Now, if so far we felt that John is only talking about fellowshipping with God, he is now bringing in the horizontal aspect, and that is our fellowship with fellow Christians, those who have accepted Christ in their lives. And he's saying that, you know, we cannot claim that God's love is in us while we hate our brothers and sisters. Okay, so some of us as believers, we might feel that as long as I have a strong relationship with God, you know, I am living a sin-free life, I am praying, I'm worshiping, I'm in the Word, it's fine, because it can be very difficult for us to relate with people. We may also have some very challenging relationships, you know, particularly challenging relationships. So it might seem easier for us to actually let go of relationships and just maintain our fellowship with the Lord. But what the Bible is encouraging us to do is to check our life with other believers as well. So our fellowship with God is important, but our fellowship with human beings is also important. Now, the reason for that fellowship to be cut off is hatred towards our brothers, then, you know, John is very clearly saying that, you know, how can you claim that you have fellowship with God and you're walking in the light and you hate your own brother? So vertical must be correct, but horizontal must also be correct. Okay, so for a believer who's walking right, his earthly relationships with other believers is also crucial. So he has to make sure that he has love in his heart. Because if he does not have love in his heart, what is John describing that person as? He's saying, darkness has blinded his eyes. Okay? So, having that right attitude towards other believers is also important, right? So that genuine love we must maintain for other believers. Now moving forward, in the next section here, I told you that he calls people by various titles, and that is probably their way of addressing an audience. So he calls some people as children, and then he calls some people as young men, and finally he calls, you know, some people as fathers. So this indicates to us that in our spiritual walk with God, there is a journey which we make, okay? And in that journey, we must progress, move, you know, one level at a time into the next phase where God is calling us. So some could be children. We have been children when we accepted the Lord Jesus, and we have experienced the forgiveness of our sins. You know, that is the first experience, isn't it? We come into salvation and we are rather new in our faith. The common experience that all the young believers have is that sense of forgiveness. I remember I met one brother who had accepted Christ very, very shortly after he accepted Christ, and the topic that he was talking to me about was the song Amazing Grace. And he said, you know, whenever I think about that song, it makes me cry, because I can think about the forgiveness of the Lord Jesus, the way he has forgiven me, the life that I was living, and now that I am in Christ Jesus, all that guilt, shame is removed, and I can experience the joy of God's deliverance in my life. So that common knowledge of young believers is forgiveness, even by way of experience. So he's saying, you know, little children, because your sins are forgiven, he's addressing the group of people. And he knows that in any community, healthy community, there will be people at various stages of growth. Okay, so it's not just children who exist there, but you have people in other stages. So he addresses the next stage here. He says, I write to you fathers because you have known him who is from the beginning. So you notice here, fathers are people who have made that journey with God. And how beautiful, he says, you have known him. So for us to go to that level of becoming a father and a mother in the Lord, we have to know him. And that knowing does not come overnight. Okay? It's a pattern of living that we adopt. It's a pattern of living that we develop step by step in our reading of the word, in our responding to the direction of the Holy Spirit, in our understanding of the word, in our fellowship with God, in our fellowship with people, in our acceptance and surrender to what God is calling us to do. What is happening? You know, we are just moving into maturity. We are moving higher and higher. And then, you know, we come to this place. If you look at fathers and mothers, what is their speciality? You know, they are mature. Yeah, and we call them mature because they are able to make decisions. They are able to nurture others. They are selfless. Okay, where they think about their children more, and you know, they are okay to forego certain things or go through some hardships for the sake of the younger ones. And that is why we honor them, because you know, they take care of us. Right? They are mature. They have wisdom. So just think about the pattern that one needs to develop over the long term. Now, again, we're all moving towards maturity. So it's not to make anybody feel guilty. Oh, no, you're not a father. You're not a mother. No, that's for God to tell, right? Like, who has grown into that kind of maturity? But the point I'm making is, we can all aspire, we can desire to grow in the Lord and come up higher and you know, come to that level where we too can be called as fathers or mothers, where we have a contribution to make to the body of Christ. So he's addressing some of these people as fathers, and what is their uniqueness? They have known him. Okay, so they have developed a pattern of fellowshipping with God. And then he also addresses another group where he says, young men. Okay, young men, because you have overcome the wicked one. So young men could be the people in the in-between stages. You know, they have learned to apply the word. They have learned to live victoriously. And we know that in this world, our enemy is Satan. And we are fighting against the attacks of the evil one. So a young person in their walk with the Lord is somebody who has learned to apply the truth, okay, and thereby experiencing victory in their walk with God. So he's addressing, you know, people of different levels, and he's talking to them. And he says, yeah, and the word of God abides in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. So he is continuing to speak to the audience, which is the believers. Now, he's bringing in a new message. So far, we were told about what will help us have a strong connection with God, have strong fellowship with God. Okay? And he's addressing a group that is composed of people in various levels of maturity. Now comes another theme that he's going to address, which is for us not to love the world. Okay, so he says, verse 15, do not love the world or the things in the world. If anyone loves the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Okay, so now he defines one more aspect which will keep us away from our fellowship with God. What is that? Love of the world. Okay, and when he uses the term world, this is cosmos. Cosmos is the pattern or the systems of the world. And he is telling the believers that a love, or, you know, a very deep interest, a deep desire for the patterns of this world will keep us away from the love of God. So our desire for God has to surpass our desire for worldly things. Now we'll go on to see, you know, what exactly he wants to say. Verse 16, for all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is of the world. So he says that in the world, you have certain things that draw your attention, or they lure you. What are these things? He says the lust of the flesh. Okay, the lust of the flesh. So lust of the flesh has to do with us experiencing certain things that gratify us. For example, I would like to eat delicious food because it satisfies me. Okay, or, you know, I would like to have certain experiences because it satisfies me. You know, I want to travel, I want to touch something, I want to wear something. So the things that satisfy me when I engage in them. So the lust, he uses the term lust. Lust is an unhealthy desire. Okay, it's an unhealthy, strong desire for things which God does not want for us. Okay? Now, is it wrong for us to experience the good which is in the world? Definitely no, because what does God's word say? He has created all things for our pleasure, right? He has created things for us to experience as a blessing. But the term lust there is to show us that a normal desire is now blown out of proportion. And it's not healthy anymore. So when our normal desire becomes lust, that is not godly. Okay. And we are told here the lust of the flesh, things that we want to experience to gratify our flesh, that is not of God. Then he says, lust of the eyes. There can be certain things that we look at which gratify us. Okay. We may not do it, we may not necessarily engage in those things, but just having a look at those things might satisfy us. For example, you know, I've heard of people when they're fasting, right? They're not eating food, but they don't mind looking at pictures of food. Why? Because it gives them a sense of, okay, maybe when I finish my fasting, I'll go to this restaurant, I'm going to have this food, it's so delicious. Just looking at it satisfies you, right? So now we know that in the area of sexuality, right, a lot of believers struggle. Lust of the flesh is to engage in immoral sexual activity to receive gratification from it. So you do it to get the satisfaction. But lust of the eyes is when people don't really do anything, but you know they watch stuff on the internet. They might watch stuff on like anything. Some picture just has their attention, and you know, they look at it. The first look we say is not your mistake, because you didn't know there was such a picture that's going to show up on your computer or on the billboard. But when we take a second look, it is a choice that we are making. Okay, so that is the lust of the eyes, because you want to look at it because it makes you satisfied, or at least the illusion of satisfaction. Because we know in Hebrews, we are told that sin entangles. Okay, it's an illusion of satisfaction, but it can never satisfy you. It will only take you deeper and deeper into worse things that will entangle or make you a slave of that particular habit. So the lust of the eyes, where an individual does not really need to engage in sin as an activity, but just having a look at stuff can satisfy them. So the lust of the eyes. And then there is the pride of life. He talks about the pride of life, where our reputation and our image before man is more important to us than our image before God. Right? So what can we do as believers? You know, we might try to do different things that make us look good, you know, have certain resources, have some products that make us look like, wow, oh, do you know this person? Wow, you know, they're so they're so great, they're so rich, or they're so powerful, they're so influential. So that image which we want to project to the world at the cost of our relationship with God. Now, that's not something God wants for us. And he says, you know, don't go by all these things, because it's not real. Okay, it'll only put you on the wrong path, promising satisfaction, but there will be no satisfaction. Now, if you look at this verse 16 of 1 John chapter 2, you will be able to relate with what happened to Eve. Okay, so what happened to Eve in the garden? Any thoughts?
She was deceived by the devil.
Correct. She was deceived by Satan. Can you relate what happened to her with this verse, Dave? Can you try?
The lust of the eye and the lust of the flesh. Yeah, when the devil described how it's so lovely to eat, so lovely to taste. Yeah.
Yes, very right. So same thing, no?
Friday.
Same thing. Exactly. So when she saw the fruit, the lust of the eyes, it was good. Okay? And, she thought, oh, wow, this, it'll be good to taste. And, you know, the lust of the flesh, where you want to experience it. So why did she want to eat it? Because the enemy had deceived her and told her, if you have this, then you will be like God. You know, you will know all things. And she wanted that pride of life. So all three things, and this is the deceptive work of the devil, and we generally say that don't be ignorant of the tactics of the devil. And do you notice his tactics remain the same? What he did in the garden, he continues to do today in our lives. Okay, so beware. John is saying, look, believer, I want you to be stable. I want you to have a strong relationship with God. And don't make that relationship a facade, but let it be a real life experience of fellowshipping with the Godhead continually, walking in the truth, walking in the commandments of God, loving people faithfully, genuinely, okay, and not loving the world, and always being aware that the enemy is out there to tempt us, and he might try it in different ways. Okay, the temptation might come in different ways, but don't give in to it, believer. Be stable. So in the book of John, we 1 John is actually writing about the lifestyle which will keep us stable in God. Okay, and we'll see further what he says in verse 17. He's saying, and the world is passing away and the lust of it, but he who does the will of God abides forever. So why is John warning the believer about giving into the lust? He's saying, look, this world is temporary, you know, and for us, we can easily be swayed by temporary things if we are not careful. But remember, we said the fathers, you have known God, you have known him, he writes to the father, right? The fathers or those who are mature. So how did they know God over time? See, our desire for God has to surpass our desire for worldly things, because we realize the difference between eternal things and temporal things. Now, again, let's not think that, you know, God only wants us to live like monks or go off on a mountain somewhere and leave the world behind so that we don't get tainted or tempted by the world. No, that's not the message that John is bringing. He's saying when we are in the world, there is that temptation. But, you know, from within, if we prioritize eternity, we will invest more in eternity, and the temporal things will not get our attention. So what is the focus here? The focus is eternal things. So we must know the value of eternal things, and ultimately the things of this world, for example, you know, he was talking about lust, isn't it? In verse 17, he's saying, why would you invest in the world or cosmos, this world system, because that is also passing away, you know? And you are not going to have any eternal rewards from there. So have the love of God as your the main thing, your main focus, and don't let temporal things sway you away. Okay, are you all with me so far? Any thoughts, any questions, or it's fine?
It's fine, ma'am.
Okay, great. Okay, wonderful. Okay, let's move on to the next passage here. Okay, the next passage, you know, he begins to talk about the Antichrist. And he also uses the term in plural, like many have come, who have been like this Antichrist. So would you want to read the passage, or I'll just go ahead and explain? What would you all prefer? Have you read and come? Okay, it's only if you read and come that it makes sense for me to just keep going. Have you all been able to read it? Okay, we can go ahead as well. So that's the same. Yeah, okay, great, great. Then we won't read it like line by line. Fine. So here, he's talking about the last hour in verse 18. And he says that we've heard that the Antichrist is coming. Even now, many Antichrists have come. By way, we know that it is the last hour. So he is talking about an opposing spirit that denies Christ. Okay, so the opposite of Christ is Antichrist, or somebody who is not for acknowledging the Christ is Antichrist. So he refers to an individual who will show up in the last days as the Antichrist, but he also says that a lot of such people, now many have come. He says, even now many Antichrists have come, by which we know that it is the last hour. So the apostles in their writings, you know, some of them, they warn about these deceptive people who do not acknowledge Christ as the Son of God. Okay, so all these deceptive people can be called as Antichrist because they're opposing who the Lord Jesus is. But among them, one person stands out as the Antichrist, and especially your batch, you have studied the end times, and you know about this Antichrist who will arise, he will lead the tribulation, and you know how things from then on will move to the culmination of the world as we know it, and you know certain events that follow after that. So now he's basically warning about deception in the last days. You know, once again, John's message is about stability. He's saying, be stable, believer. All these things are due to happen. And you know, he talks about some of these people who do not acknowledge Christ. And he's saying some of them went out from us. Okay. So by that, what does he mean? He means that there were people who probably pretended like they accepted Christ, but they were never really obedient to the message of Christ. And finally, what did they do? They have got out from among the community of believers to live a life which does not glorify God. So, you know, he makes the point and he says that they probably people who never really accepted Christ. That is why they have gone astray in this manner. So I'll read that verse for you for clarity. Verse 19, they went out from us, but they were not of us. For if they had been of us, they would have continued with us. But they went out that they might be made manifest that none of them were of us. So he's saying the people who have gone astray in this manner, no, they were never really a part of us. Okay, so these kind of incidents happen. Now, is John talking about a believer who has left the community? No, he is not talking about a believer for whatever reason he leaves the community. No, he's talking about somebody who is deceived to the point of rejecting Christ, who has gone out of the community of believers with the intention of not following Christ at all, and on the other hand, opposing the same message of the gospel. So, you know, somebody who has gone out in that way, they probably never really accepted Christ, is what he is saying. And then he goes on to say that we as believers, we can have a discerning spirit. So remember, he said that stability for a believer is important. He says, look, in the last days, there will be deceivers of this kind. But one good thing is that God has given us the Holy Spirit. And he uses the term anointing, the anointing from the Holy One. Who is this anointing from the Holy One? He is the Holy Spirit. And what can we do through this Holy Spirit? You know, this Holy Spirit, he knows all things. And John teaches us, and he says that he will teach us, right? He is in you and he will teach you the truth. He will teach you, you know, discernment, so that you would know who these people are and how you ought to live your life. In fact, verse 27, if you just jump all the way to verse 27, he says, but the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need anyone teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you will abide in him. So basically, you know, he's calling the believer to abide or to live with Christ. And how can a believer maintain that stable walk and dwell, stay, abide with Christ, that constant fellowship, even by through the instruction of the Holy Spirit? Okay, so John is saying the Holy Spirit will teach you all things. Now, does it mean that the believer does not need, you know, any teachers of the word? Not at all. You know, whenever we interpret scripture, we interpret it in the light of other scripture. Now we know that God is the one who has given teachers, right, in the body of Christ. So there was no need of teaching the word of God. Why would there be teachers? Obviously, there is a role which teachers play. However, every believer has this beautiful privilege of the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, who's also termed here as the anointing. So the anointing in you will teach you all things. Now, if you recall Romans chapter 8 and verse 16, where Paul wrote and he said that the Holy Spirit in you will bear witness. Okay, so the bearing of witness about what is right, what is wrong, who is this Antichrist, what is deceptive in the world. We have the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit to teach us all these things. So a believer need not be afraid. He can continue to trust God, that God will help him or her to live a stable Christian life. Okay, so that is the point that he's making. And over here, the key word for us is abide in him. Remember, even in John chapter 1, the whole point was to say have fellowship with God. Okay, and abide is what? Abide is stay. It's only when we have fellowship. See, when we have very strong fellowship, we tend to spend more time with whoever, you know, our friends. If you have a very close friend, you might spend more time with that friend in comparison to others who are just, you know, regular friends. But what is the difference? The staying, right, longer with that close friend. Now, take it a step higher. You know, living, abiding, dwelling. Like if you're staying together, you know, that shows that you really want to spend a lot of time in the presence of that individual. So in that same way, we are invited to actually live with God and to never move out of his pavilion. You know, the way Psalm 91, he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High will abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And what does John the Apostle want for the believer? Not theory. He's saying, on the earth, without being corrupted by the sin of this world, without being deceived by, you know, even the so-called Antichrist, we can live a stable life. We can live a very satisfying, fruitful life, fellowshipping with the Godhead right here. Okay, and that is the privilege of a believer. And he's inviting every believer to live in that manner. So what we'll do is, at this point, we will stop. We will come back. We'll pick up from the last few verses of chapter 2 and continue into chapter 3. Okay, so if you have any questions, please do bring it up in the next session. Okay, let's go for a break now. Thank you.